Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjaleyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Kovilvanni. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture in the subject Gas Dynamics and Jet Propulsion. This is lecture number 31. The topic is Rocket Propulsion Part 1. In the earlier lectures, we discussed the aircraft propulsion, performance of aircraft propulsion, and we solved a few problems on the aircraft propulsion, and in this lecture we are going to discuss the rocket propulsion and its types, theory of rocket propulsion, performance of rocket propulsion, and we will discuss liquid propellant rockets. The learning outcome to the students: at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to classify the rocket propulsion, calculate the efficiencies of the rocket propulsion, and explain the liquid propellant rockets. So, the schematic diagram of the rocket engine is shown in the figure. There are three main parts in the rocket system, rocket propulsion system. The first part is propellant control and navigational equipment, and second part is thrust chamber, and third one is propelling nozzle. So, in the first part, propellant control and navigational equipments, we have all the equipment, propellant, oxidizer, everything, whatever required, maybe the storage place for the entire system. And here we have the storage point for the propellant, storage point for the fuel, oxidizer, and all the navigational control equipment, everything will be here in the first part. Then here in the thrust chamber, the fuel and oxidizer, they are injected. So, the supply of fuel and the oxidizer is taking place in the thrust chamber, and the combustion of the fuel is taking place in this thrust chamber. So, because of the combustion, the hot gases are produced, and the hot gases are then flowing through the propelling nozzle, which is a converging diverging nozzle. So, the nozzle converts the gas enthalpy into a jet of higher velocity. So, with that velocity, the force is produced, and the thrust is produced, and thrust makes the rocket to move forward in the opposite direction of the jet. So, these are all the basic components of the rocket propulsion system. Now, we will discuss in detail about the working of the various types of rocket and calculating the performance of the rocket engine in this lecture. Classification of rocket. So, based on the source of energy employed, the rockets are classified into four types: chemical rocket, this may be liquid propellant rocket, solid propellant rocket, or hybrid propellant rocket. So, we will be discussing in detail about the liquid propellant, solid propellant, and the hybrid propellant rocket in this lecture. And there are solar rockets, so the source of energy is solar energy. Nuclear rocket, the source of energy is nuclear energy, thermal energy obtained by nuclear fission process. And the electrical rocket, the source of energy is electrical energy, which is again using the storage battery, we are taking the electric energy. And based on the propellant use, the rockets are liquid propellant rocket, solid propellant rocket, or hybrid propellant rocket. So, this is again based on the types of propellant, liquid propellant, solid propellant, and the hybrid propellant. And based on the application, the rockets are space rocket, military rocket, weather or sounding rocket, booster rocket, or retro rocket. The space rocket, so the space applications, the rockets used for the space applications, space rockets, military rockets, the rockets used for military application like missiles, weather or sounding rockets, they are used to launch the satellite in the orbit, and booster rocket, it is also to boost the step by step two stages of rocket. And the retro rocket, so it is used in the returning of this space flight to reduce the velocity of the space flight, we are using the retro rocket. And based on the number of stages, the rockets are single stage rocket or the multi stage rocket. And based on the size and range, the rockets are short range small rockets, long range small rocket, long range large rockets. So, depending on the size and the application, there are three types. And the theory of propulsion, rocket propulsion, so we said, so the entire rocket, we have the control surface, the rocket, you have the rocket where you have the navigational equipment and propellant array, thrust chamber, the nozzle, and these are all the designation. So we select a control surface. PA is the atmospheric pressure, PE is the exit pressure, C is the exit velocity, MP is the mass of the propellant, and the thrust is produced by the jet of the gases. The thrust is the force that propels a rocket at the given velocity. So the force produced by the gas jet. So the force produced by the gas jet is also the thrust, or the power required to propel the rocket is the thrust. So F equal to F of MOM, momentum thrust plus pressure thrust. So total thrust equal to momentum thrust plus pressure thrust. The momentum thrust is obtained by multiplying the mass of the propellant into the exit velocity. So mass into velocity, that is momentum. So MP into CE plus the pressure thrust equal to area into change in the pressure. So area, exit area of the nozzle, exit area of the nozzle into PE minus PA. PE is the exit pressure and PA is the ambient pressure or atmospheric pressure. So the thrust is equal to MP into CE plus AE into PE into PA. And this is the very with respect to altitude, how the thrust is varying. So for kilometer, in terms of kilometer, thrust is increasing. And effective jet velocity. So hypothetical velocity defined as the velocity of the jet when the gas through the nozzle expanded to the ambient pressure. So the effective jet velocity, so the gases are expanded. So as we said, the gases are expanded in the nozzle, which produces the velocity. So the effective jet velocity is when the exit pressure, we assume that exit pressure is atmospheric pressure, then the velocity is effective jet velocity. Considering the effective jet velocity, thrust equation may be written as MP into CE plus AE into PE minus PA equal to MP into CJ. So CJ is the effective jet velocity. Specific impulse, the thrust per unit weight flow rate of unit weight flow of the propellant, it is called as specific impulse, I equal to F by WP. So thrust F is the thrust force and the weight of the propellant. Weight of the propellant equal to mass of the propellant multiplied by the acceleration due to gravity. The specific propellant consumption, weight flow rate of propellant required to produce unit thrust. So the reverse of I. So this SPC equal to WP by F or 1 by I. So weight flow coefficient CW equal to WP by PO into A star. So where PO is the stagnation pressure at the entry of the nozzle, A star is the nozzle throat area. So this is the weight flow coefficient, WP is the weight of the propellant. And the thrust coefficient F divided by PO into A star. F is the thrust, PO is the stagnation pressure at the entry of the nozzle, A star is the throat area of the nozzle. Impulse to weight ratio, IWR equal to IT divided by WT. So IT is the, earlier we discussed the specific impulse divided by WT. And the characteristics velocity V star equal to CJ by CF, that is effective jet velocity divided by thrust coefficient. And the propulsive efficiency we calculate, eta P equal to thrust power divided by engine output power. The thrust power equal to MP into CJ into U divided by 1 by 2 MP into CJ square plus U square. So simplifying, this will be 2 sigma divided by 1 plus sigma square, where sigma equal to rocket to jet speed ratio. So U is the rocket speed, CJ is the jet speed, so this is called as sigma, the velocity ratio or the speed ratio of the rocket. And this is how the speed, with respect to speed ratio, how the propulsive efficiency is changing. So propulsive efficiency initially increasing, then it decreases. And thermal efficiency equal to engine output power divided by the power input to the power input through the fuel. By supplying, by burning the fuel, the power produced in the denominator. Engine output power is 1 by 2 MP into CJ square plus U square divided by power out input, power input by the fuel equal to mass of the propellant into QR. QR is the heat of reaction of the propellant. So this will be equal to CJ square plus U square divided by 2 into QR. MP is getting cancelled, CJ square plus U square divided by 2 into QR. Then overall efficiency equal to propulsive power divided by power input through the fuel, which is propulsive efficiency into thermal efficiency. So the product of the propulsive efficiency and thermal efficiency, that gives the overall efficiency of the rocket engine. And we discussed the working of rocket liquid propellant rocket engine. So look at the rocket construction of the liquid propellant rocket engine. We have the fuel tank. So the fuel tank and auxiliary tank at the front, and we have the pipeline which is carrying the fuel and the auxiliary to the thrust chamber or the combustion chamber, and we have the control valve to regulate the amount of oxidizer and amount of the fuel required for the combustion based on the requirement of velocity. And in the combustion chamber, the combustion of the fuel and the oxidizer is taking place, hot gases are produced and the hot gases are expanded through the exhaust nozzle. So the velocity, jet velocity, exit velocity is CE, the jet of higher velocity is produced. There are different types of liquid propellant rocket. So the liquid types of liquid propellants are storable propellant, cryogenic propellant, monopropellant and the bipropellants. So these are all the different types of liquid propellants used in the rocket engine. So storable propellant can be stored in the liquid state at ambient temperature. So the storable, so we can store in the liquid state. And the cryogenic propellant are in the gaseous state in normal temperature, and at low temperature is required to maintain them in the liquid state. So they are called as cryogenic liquid. So majority of the liquid system, the gas actually at atmospheric temperature, normal temperature, the propellant will be in the gaseous state. So we maintain low temperature. So maintaining low temperature is cryogenic. So low temperature is required to maintain them in the liquid state. So when you maintain them in the liquid state, we can store more quantity. We can carry more quantity of the propellant with the rocket. So liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen, liquid fluorine and liquid ammonia are commonly used cryogenic propellant. So this is they actually liquid, these are all the cryogenic propellant. So the propellant which are maintained at lower temperature, which are maintained in the liquid state at lower temperature, they are called as cryogenic propellant. Monopropellant, some liquid propellant can be used as a monopropellant which contains both fuel and the oxidizer in a single chemical. So normally a single chemical will be sufficient for initiating the combustion and producing the hot gases. They are called as monopropellant. The monopropellant are stable at normal temperature and decomposes and burn to release the heat energy on heating or ignition. So at a normal working condition, they will be stable, and when the ignition starts, they will decompose, the element will become fuel and the oxidizer, and the combustion of the fuel will be taking place. So hydrogen peroxide, H2O2, hydrogen, N2H4, nitroglycerin, nitromethane, they are the monopropellant. Next is bipropellant. So most of the propellant used in the liquid rocket engine, they are bipropellant, where you have fuel and the oxidizer in a they are separate chemicals. So fuel is stored in a tank and oxidizer is stored in another tank, and they are mixed together in the combustion chamber and the combustion is initiated. So in the bipropellant, there are again two types, diergols, so which require the ignition for initiating the combustion of the fuel and the oxidizer for energy release, and the hypergols, they do not require ignition and they start chemical reaction as soon as the two chemicals come in contact with each other. So we bipropellant, there is a separate fuel and separate oxidizer. They two will be injected into the fuel and the oxidizer will be injected into the combustion chamber, and the combustion is initiated by the ignition. So here we have diergols. So diergols require a separate ignition system to initiate the combustion, whereas hypergols, they can, when the fuel and the oxidizer will come into contact, they will initiate, they will start burning. That is called as hypergols. And desirable properties of liquid propellants. So the heat released during the combustion per kg of the propellant should be high. The propellant should have higher density so that they can be stored in a small tank. So higher the density, the storage space required will be less. So we can store the liquid propellant in a smaller tank. The propellant should have lower freezing point. So actually it should be stable in the liquid state. So when the freezing point is high, it will freeze into solid. So it should not happen. So it should have lower freezing point. The propellant should be non-corrosive. So it should not react with the metal container. So it should not corrode the metal container. So it should be non-corrosive. And the propellant should be chemically stable. They should not chemically react with any of the pipeline or control valve or in the tank. The properties of the propellant should be constant throughout. So the properties should not change with respect to temperature or the pressure. The propellant should have low value of vapor pressure to avoid cavitation problem in the feed system. So the vapor pressure should be low. The propellant should have low viscosity so that the pumping power required will be less. So the flow, the liquid propellants, they are flowing in the pipeline. So the lower viscosity is required so that the pumping power will be less. The propellant must have higher specific heat and the higher thermal conductivity. The thermal property should be higher, and the propellant should not be poisonous and hazardous. So it should not be poisonous or hazardous for the, so that the people working around the propellant or handling the propellant, storing the propellant, should not affect the persons working with the propellant. The propellant should be cheap and abundantly available. So these are all the desirable properties of the liquid propellant. And liquid propellant feed system. So we said there are two tanks, separate tanks, one tank for the fuel and another tank for oxidation, they are required. And the two tanks are, from the two tanks, the liquid and the liquid fuel and the liquid oxidizer, they are taken to the combustion chamber. So what is the feeding system? How they are taken from the tank to the combustion chamber? That is what the feeding system. So there are two types of feeding system: gas pressure feed system and the turbo pump feed system. So we will discuss the two feed systems separately. And this is the gas pressure feed system. So look at the construction. We have the fuel tank, oxidizer tank, and we have the pressurizing gas tank. So we have a separate gas for the pressurizing the fuel and the oxidizer. We have the control valve to regulate the pressurizing gas. So the pressurizing gas is allowed to the fuel tank through the valve. It is allowed to the oxidizer tank through the valve. And from the fuel tank, the fuel is taken to the combustion chamber. So the combustion chamber, here we have the filling and draining valve. Suppose if you want to fill the fuel tank, we are using this valve, and this is the fuel valve to regulate the quantity of the fuel supplied to the combustion chamber. And from the oxidizer tank, again we have the filling system. So the filling tank is here, filling or the draining valve is here. So using opening the valve, we can fill the oxidizer tank, or we can completely drain the oxidizer from the tank. And this is the regulation valve, so we can regulate the quantity of oxidizer flowing through the combustion chamber. Now, what is the use of this valve? Suppose how to fill the tank? So we have to close the control valve, we have to close the fuel valve. By opening the filling valve, we can admit the fuel, and the fuel will be stored in the fuel tank. Then we can close it. Now the fuel is completely filled in the tank. Similarly, oxidizer, we have to close the control valve. So here we have to close the oxidizer valve, then open the filling valve, admit the oxidizer. So the oxidizer will be stored in the oxidizer tank. It is completely filled with the oxidizer. Then you close the valve. Now for the combustion, so we have to open this valve. So open the oxidizer valve and open the fuel valve. Here again we have to open the control valve, two control valves, so that the pressurizing tank will pressurize the fluid from the top, so that they will be admitted into the combustion chamber. So the quantity of fuel and the oxidizer, they are regulated by the fuel valve and oxidizer valve. Now the oxidizer is injected at the top. Oxidizer is injected at the top, so the oxidizer will enter into the combustion chamber or the thrust chamber. Now the fuel is admitted at the bottom. So if you look at the thrust chamber, the exhaust nozzle, we have a passage. This is called as cooling jacket. So through the cooling jacket, we are supplying the fuel. So what is the advantage? The fuel is absorbing the heat energy, and the fuel is heated up. So the high temperature fuel is injected in the combustion chamber, so the combustion efficiency will increase. So the cooling jacket is filled with the fuel, so that before the fuel is admitted into the chamber, into the thrust chamber, it is heated by the walls of the combustion chamber and the exhaust nozzle. Then the hot gases are produced here, and the hot gases are expanded in the exhaust nozzle, and the gas jet is produced. So using the gas jet, the rocket is propelling in the opposite direction. And we have the turbo pump feed system. This is the turbo pump feed system. Here again we have the fuel tank, oxidizer tank, and we have the fuel pump and oxidizer pump, and we have a gas turbine. So the gas turbine is running, is giving the power. It produces power. The power produced by the gas turbine is used for the feed pump, fuel pump, and the oxidizer pump. And the gas turbine, so again, the gas turbine, we require fuel and the oxidizer. So here, there is a gas generator. So some quantity of fuel is going to the gas generator, and some quantity of oxidizer is also going to the gas generator. So the fuel and the oxidizer, they are mixed together and the gas is produced, combustion is produced, and then hot gases are goes expanded in the gas turbine to produce power, and the hot gases after producing power, they are again expanded to the turbine exhaust nozzle. This also produces some kind of thrust. And the power produced by the gas turbine is used to run the oxidizer pump and the fuel feed pump. So using the fuel pump and the oxidizer pump, the quantity of the fuel supplied to the thrust chamber and the exhaust nozzle. So here we have the injector at the top. So the fuel and the oxidizer, they are injected at the top of the thrust chamber. The combustion of the fuel and the oxidizer is taking place in the thrust chamber. Hot gases are produced and the hot gases are expanded in the exhaust nozzle to produce the gas jet. So this is the turbo pump feed system. And the combustion of liquid propellant. So the combustion process in the liquid propellant rocket engine takes place in three stages. So injection, which includes atomization, mixing and vaporization, ignition and combustion of propellant. So it is very much similar to the IC engine combustion in the IC engine. So first the fuel and the actually they are injected. So the injection, we have to inject the fuel in the fine droplets so that the atomization of the particle will takes place. So the pressure difference causes the atomization, and then they are mixing. So oxidizer and the fuel, they are mixing together, and using the temperature of the hot gases, it becomes vapor. So once the vapor is there, so the initiation, so the combustion is initiated by means of ignition, then the combustion of the propellant takes place. The complete and efficient combustion of liquid propellant depends on the oxidizer fuel ratio, the combustion temperature, time and space available in the combustion chamber, effective injection of the fuel and oxidizer with the same degree of fineness to facilitate the mixing and the vaporization of the fuel and the oxidizer, the degree of turbulence created in the combustion chamber. So we require certain degree of turbulence for effective mixing of fuel and the oxidizer, the pressure drop between thrust chamber and the fuel line. So the pressure difference should be higher so that the atomization will be effective. So the atomization depends on the pressure difference between the thrust chamber and the fuel line. The fuel injector orifice geometry and the size of the fuel injector orifice and the geometry is very important, because the atomization, the spray depends on the fuel injector orifice and the size, and the ignition at right timing. So timing of injection, these are all the important parameter or attributes for efficient and complete combustion of the liquid propellant in the combustion chamber. And advantages of liquid propellant rocket: the specific impulse obtained is high. So the power produced, so because we can store a separate liquid and the fuel, so the power produced or the specific impulse is very high. Liquid propellant rockets engines are suitable for long range space and military applications. So because we can store more quantity of liquid and the oxidizer, liquid fuel and the liquid oxidizer, so they can be used for a longer range and military application. The engine can be easily controlled by the regulating the flow of the propellant. So we can control the flow of liquid propellant and liquid fuel and the liquid oxidizer depending on the jet velocity required. Stopping of the engine is also, emergency is also easy. So we can just regulate the quantity of the fuel supply, or we can stop the quantity of fuel supply so that we can stop the engine. The thrust chamber and the nozzle are cooled by circulation of propellant so that structural strength is more. So we can cool the system, the entire thrust chamber, using the propellant so that we can increase the strength. The propellant are stored in a separate tank, so a compact and aerodynamically and structurally better combustion chamber design is possible. So because the size of the combustion chamber, efficient combustion depends on the aerodynamic and structurally better combustion chamber. Aerodynamic means we have to produce turbulence inside the combustion chamber. The liquid propellant rocket engine are most effective as they can be reused after recovery. So we can recover the liquid propellant rocket engine and we can refill the liquid and the propellant so that we can reuse the liquid propellant rocket. And disadvantages of liquid propellant rocket engine: the design of liquid propellant rocket engine is complicated. So we require a separate tank, we require the feeding system, we require the pump, we require the piping pipeline for the taking the fuel and the access to the combustion chamber. So the design is little complicated. Malfunctioning of the propellant feed system or control valve leads to failure. The liquid propellant rocket are cryogenic, which requires special arrangement for storing and handling. So cryogenic liquid propellant, we have to maintain low temperature, then only we can maintain them, we can retain them in the liquid state. So maintaining the cryogenic condition requires some special arrangement for storing and handling. Large storage space is required for comparing with the solid propellant, which will raise the size and the weight of the engine. So the space required is more, but this can be used for the long range application. That is another advantage. So we require more space for storing the liquid propellant. So it can be used for a longer range. The storable liquid propellant are poisonous and corrosive, which require safe handling system. So we have to be very serious. We have to be very carefully handle the store the liquid propellant in the tank. The longer time is required to design, manufacture and the manufacture of liquid propellant rocket. So we require more time because we have to design the tank, we have to prepare the design plan for arrangement of various equipments. So the time required for liquid propellant rocket engine is more comparing with the solid propellant rocket. We stop here. So these are all the books I have written in the mechanical engineering subject. You can refer to it for your better learning. So there is one book, Gas Dynamics in Jet Propulsion. You can refer to it for better preparation. I upload the video lectures of all the subject in the YouTube channel. You subscribe the channel, use the video lectures for your better preparation. So thank you for watching. Please post your comments on the comments box. You can contact me through my mail ID or WhatsApp number for any clarification subject. We'll continue with the rocket propulsion system in the next lecture also.